America is essentially a dream.
Good afternoon, you're tuned to Network X. I'm Jenny DeMoto, the host this evening, and tonight our show is regarding the VA hospital and its incinerator. We want to shut it down due to its incineration. And with me tonight, I have Laurie Valeriano from the Washington Toxics Coalition and Stella Chao from the Community Coalition for Environmental Justice. Welcome, both of you.
Thanks.
And let's just get into the group revolving or spearheading this action to shut down the VA hospital incinerator. It's Seattle Healthcare Without Harm.
Right. Well, Seattle Healthcare Without Harm is a branch of a national organization that works to shut down medical waste incineration across the country. And it's a group that has coalition members that include Washington Toxics Coalition, Community Coalition for Environmental Justice, a youth group called Wilderness Inner City Leadership Development, or WILD, and Physicians for Social Responsibility, as well as many community members from around the Beacon Hill and the North Seattle area.
Mm-hmm. So. Great. So. The history of shutting down hospital incinerators, is it a recent history, or is it something that has just started in the last 10 years? Or
probably in the last 10 years is when we first started to look at it, because we found out that hospitals are a source of dioxin, specifically the incinerators that they operate to burn their waste. And communities and people who live in the communities got very concerned about dioxin. It's a very well known carcinogen. It's been known in Agent Orange, and that's how people started to become aware of it. So then when people realized it was, you know, coming out of hospitals, it was kind of outrageous, because hospitals are meant to heal people,
sure,
not make them sick.
Sure.
So, you know, probably in the late 80s, early 90s, people started to really look at these hospital incinerators and start to shut them down, mm-hmm, and try to get hospitals to promote to use alternatives.
Mm-hmm. And the hospitals in Seattle now have begun to jump on that bandwagon and find alternatives to getting rid of their waste. And I know that Swedish has converted to autoclaving, or I don't know what they're doing now, but they've since stopped incinerating their waste. And at this point, Northwest Hospital and the VA Hospital, which is located on Beacon Hill, are the two major problems right now in our immediate community.
Well, I believe they're the only hospitals in the Seattle area that have on-site incineration in a residential neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And all of the other hospitals have changed to alternative technologies for disinfection, as well as employing other strategies such as better recycling programs, new purchasing protocols, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, let's talk about the VA hospital. It's on Beacon Hill, and I actually live very near there, and it's basically the only large business of its kind on the hill, and it's right smack in the center of the hill, where it's primarily residential and businesses that support residential living. So
not only is it right in the middle of the residential area, but there are a lot of recreational activities that happen right around the Beacon Hill Medical Waste Incinerator there at the VA Hospital. You have the Jefferson Community Center. You have the golf course right across the street. There's a middle school across the street as well. And there are some Seattle Public Utility reservoirs also adjacent to the property.
Right, so. Our water source.
Right.
So great. So their incinerator has been going since 86. Mm-hmm. And at what point did, how did they go about getting that put in? Was it?
They built it.
They just built it. There's no public. Mm-hmm.
Well, no, I mean, the VA decided at some point that they wanted to build this new incinerator, and they went ahead and put this incinerator in. And our local air pollution control agency, which is called the Puget Sound Air Pollution Control Agency, essentially said, well, no, you really can't do that without a permit, number one. Number two, your incinerator is not up to snuff. It essentially does not have the technology that's acceptable to us.
Mm-hmm.
And they went ahead to, and proceeded to shut them down. Then after, you know, series of court battles, it's sort of been litigious throughout the whole life of this incinerator, VA essentially had to put on new pollution control technology, and they went ahead and did that, and now they operate that incinerator with the current pollution control technology, which is still described by PSAPCA as a dismal failure and something that, you know, is sort of a hodgepodge of pollution control devices.
Mm-hmm.
Which is extremely concerning, especially because the incinerator is discharging dioxin, lead, mercury, cadmium, a whole variety of pollutants that, you know, that are unnecessarily being discharged into the Beacon Hill community.
Mm-hmm.
And throughout the environment.
So what's going on there with PSAPCA? Are they the regulators of air quality regarding incinerating and those type of things? Like, when mm-hmm. Do they have the power to step in and do go beyond just modifying the equipment?
Sure.
Can't they step in and?
Yeah, I mean, they could go ahead and they could, you know, put on more stringent requirements for the incinerators. One way they could do that would be to pursue rulemaking, which essentially says we're going to make regulations that apply to both the VA hospital and the other hospital that still has an incinerator, is the Northwest Hospital.
Mm-hmm.
And then those two incinerate, and they could make them more stringent, those rules more stringent than what they currently have to do to comply with their permit. And they could certainly do that. They just haven't done that.
Mm-hmm.
There's also a difference in the way that PSAPCA has been allowing the permit on allowable burning between the two hospitals and other area hospitals. I believe that Northwest Hospital's permit allows them to burn 20 tons a month or around there. And the VA hospital's permit gives them an allowable 120 tons per month. Not that they necessarily burn that each month, but there seems to be a discrepancy in allowable burning on the permits, and that's where environmental justice comes in, because most of the residents of the Beacon Hill community, which is a very diverse community, are people of color.
Mm-hmm. So that's what CCEJ and Seattle Healthcare Without Harm, that's what your goal is to educate the community on Beacon Hill and get people out there on the steps of the VA to shut down the incinerator.
Right.
Right. So how has that been going?
Well, we've had our first community meeting, which happened on Saturday the 13th.
Mm-hmm.
And we had about 30 people at the meeting throughout the meeting time, the 2 hours we were there, who were very interested in the issue. It was a mixture of residents, organizations, and community officials, people from neighborhood planning. There were representatives from the mayor's office there as well. And we were able to outline a strategy for raising awareness in the community and get people to sign on to specific letter writing and flyer distribution campaigns. And we also set our next community meeting for July 11th mm-hmm. from 10 o'clock until noon at the Jefferson Community Center.
Okay, we'll prompt that okay. later in the show. But why don't you hold up that flyer too?
About a month ago, there's a flyer here that the Wild Youth Group developed and distributed around the community in Beacon Hill to begin raising awareness of the community residents that there was an incinerator in their neighborhood, as well as the dangers.
Right. That's how I found out about it. It was a really effective piece of literature.
So between the Wild Youth and the youth from the Western Washington University, while they were on their break, they distributed about 400 copies mm-hmm. of these around the neighborhood.
They're great. I'm going to keep one on file and just start Xeroxing them and, you know, handing them out to people in the neighborhood. And maybe we should put the CCEJ contact, the address and phone number up as well, so that people can request these flyers, and it tells it in a nutshell what's going on, you know, how much of a hazard incinerating medical waste is, and how it's happening right in the community of Beacon Hill, and should really get the word out. So call that number, or write them, and they'll very gladly and quickly send off some flyers to and that's really the point here, is we want to get people to know about the incinerator, and at which point I think once they know, then they'll act. And that's another thing, is another organizational meeting that will be happening when is that? July
11th.
July 11th.
At the Jefferson Community Center mm-hmm. from 10 until noon.
Yeah.
For people who are interested in getting more detailed information, there was an excellent article printed in this week's International Examiner newspaper and distributed, written by one of the staff at the Community Coalition for Environmental Justice. Her name is Christine Wong. And edited by Eric Sue of the International Examiner. And I think it's a very good article that gives a lot of information, a lot of facts, some history, and possible strategies for the future.
Great. Yeah, I'm interested in the history of it all, because it really seems like if a hospital is able to just decide, hey, we're going to go this route now, we'll just incinerate our waste, and not really have to. I guess the VA didn't, since it's a government agency, they know their way around the system and can just, you know. So I'm thinking maybe going through PSAPCA as well as you know, writing the VA, but calling PSAPCA and saying, you know, what's going on here? Don't we need some more loop? You know, mm-hmm. rules and regulations, and mm-hmm. and that's kind of in your realm as a Washington Toxics Coalition lobbyist, is it not?
I'm not a lobbyist. I'm an organizer, but but I can lobby. Grassroots lobbying.
Uh-huh. You know. How does that come about? Is that a very easy process to change PSAPCA or instigate legislation?
It's a difficult process, but what we found oftentimes in the history of activism is that when people get angry and they get mobilized and they press for action, the government agencies will respond. Mm-hmm. And I think in this case, you know, more and more people are becoming aware. I mean, I've gotten more calls in the past week than I've gotten in the 3 years I've been looking, you know, and working on this issue.
Uh-huh.
So I think that it's a definite possibility. But I think that the real solution is not standards, it's not more regulation, even though that will make it, you know, a little bit more safe. The answer is to shut down the incinerator. And the answer is for the hospitals to really rethink the way that they're approaching their entire way of doing business when it comes to waste, purchasing disposables, you know, versus reusables, purchasing toxic products versus non-toxic products. And they really need to refocus their energies on preventing pollution, not what do we do at the very end of the stack in order to control it. Because of, you know, even if you capture the pollutants in the pollution control devices, you're still dumping it into a landfill. You know, incinerators create toxic ash. Mm-hmm. Some of it goes to a hazardous waste landfill, some of it goes to a regular landfill. So it's not really solving the problem. Hospitals really need to get in at the front end and do, you know, waste audits, figure out how to really focus in on reducing their waste before they should talk about whether or not to incinerate or autoclave or landfill.
Mm-hmm. What is autoclaving?
Autoclaving, it's just a steam sterilization process. Mm-hmm. You apply heat, you know, very high temperatures, and it disinfects the infectious portion of the waste stream.
Mm-hmm. But you still have your waste.
And you still have your waste. Mm-hmm. It's just disinfected, and you can put it into a landfill.
Sure. So you, the coalition has had a couple of meetings now with VA representatives.
Right. The coalition doesn't want to fight the PSAPCA and the VA on these issues. We want to work with them, mm-hmm. As other hospitals around the country have worked with different groups in order to change their practices. Maybe, Laurie, you can talk about the meeting that the coalition has had. With it.
Mm-hmm. We did have a meeting with the veterans folks, and they essentially said a number of things. One is that they're looking at alternatives to incineration. They too are concerned about dioxin and lead and mercury, you know, being spewed out of the stack into the environment. So they're looking at things like autoclaving and looking at, you know, other opportunities to disinfect their waste. They're also, they've said they're going to be hiring a waste management specialist person, which means that, you know, that person will focus on looking at what's in the waste stream, figuring out how to reduce it, figuring out, you know, really what are the best ways for the hospital to manage their waste. Mm-hmm. And they also said things like they would do better education of their staff, because what's happening at the VA is that they're burning all their waste. That there's a, you know, there's a certain portion of the waste stream that needs to be disinfected. That's maybe 15% of mm-hmm. the waste stream. The rest of it is like household waste. It's like plastics and, you know, stuff from the cafeteria and just normal everyday waste. They're burning it all. Mm-hmm. So they want to do more education of the staff so that they know exactly what to put in the infectious waste stream bag mm-hmm. that needs to be incinerated, and then try to figure out ways to reduce, recycle the other, you know, stuff. But, you know, that's all well and good, but we want them to shut down the incinerator.
Yeah, yeah. And that way they don't have to retrain their staff.
Well, no, they should still
twice.
Do that.
Yeah.
I mean, they still need to do that, because you don't want to be autoclaving all of your, you know, office waste or
yeah.
your food waste or whatever.
Right.
They still need to do that, but they don't need to incinerate, and that's the bottom line.
Sure.
One of the issues that I think comes up on the table is the cost of changing over to the different technologies. And I think that initially, yes, we are talking about an investment here, but I think that studies have shown all over the nation that hospitals that have changed their practices have really ended up saving money in the long run,
mm-hmm.
As most recycling and reuse systems have shown. So it's just a matter of convincing people to think about the long term instead of the short term.
Sure, sure. And having a bit of a better conscience about the community that they're mm-hmm. working
Absolutely.
In. So.
Right. Uh-huh. It's also about spending money now too, you know, so that the community doesn't have to pay for cleanup costs later. Because the pollutants that they're spewing out now, someone's going to have to deal with eventually. So mm-hmm. it's thinking about future generations and the cost, you know, to them.
Has there been to date a medical waste incinerator disaster in terms of where there's been a noticeable pollutant effect on a community, like death and deformity or anything like that?
The thing about pollutants from medical waste incinerators such as dioxin is that the concern about dioxin is that it's persistent, it stays in the environment, it builds up in our bodies, and it has, you know, impacts that we cannot directly link back to the incinerator. But what we do know is that from EPA studies and things like that, is that dioxin is in our bodies at levels that are known to cause harm in animal studies. So we know we have dioxin already in our bodies. We know that it's probably the most toxic chemical out there known to science, and we know that it causes a range of things from, you know, cancer to reproductive problems to possibly immune system suppression. And what we need to do is say, you know, this is an unnecessary source. Mm-hmm. We're not going to show body bags. This is not what this issue is about. This is about preventing people from being exposed to extremely toxic chemicals, because it's really difficult to show. Mm-hmm.
Public health issues for the Beacon Hill community around this medical waste incinerator are really important, because Beacon Hill has a population that has the most number of children being born in any other neighborhood in Seattle. Mm-hmm. It's very much a new family, growing neighborhood. A lot of people are moving there to begin raising their families. So you have a lot of young children, growing children, and pregnant women. And those are the populations who are most susceptible to these health effects of dioxin and mercury, et cetera.
Sure. And on the same note, is that it's also the neighborhood being a new immigrant neighborhood, that it's a little more difficult to get the word out.
It's very difficult to get the word out. Uh-huh. There has to be a commitment to spending the time and the effort to really get into the community and make sure that they do understand and make them aware of their rights.
Mm-hmm. Well, great. Well, I definitely think the literature is helpful, and we'll put up the address and the phone number again for people to call to get that flyer.
Great.
As well as right now, in order to make a statement now with the hospital, you've had meetings, but there's a letter writing campaign going on, and maybe now's a good time to put that up as well. It's a letter writing campaign to the chief executive officer there, and that's up on the screen. So please write to old Timothy up there and let him know that you know about the incinerator and you know about health risks in, you know, coming from it, and that you'd like it shut down. I think the big statement really is just please shut down the incinerator. Mm-hmm. And find an alternative to your waste. Just like we all do. We don't all burn our waste out in our front yards.
That's a good point.
You know, that's what I thought
we
of.
We all separate.
Uh-huh. Right. We know how to do all of that. So, and especially as a business, I think that's even where recycling and alternative waste measures happen on a better scale. Like, you can't really depend on every single individual on your block doing it, because it's all personal choice. But if it's your own business, you know, you can set a policy, and and that's where it can start. So
it's also doctors who work in hospitals take an oath to do no harm.
Right.
It's pretty ironic that these hospitals themselves are spewing out these pollutants that are causing harm. So, you know, I think they have an extra responsibility to the community to do no harm.
Sure. So it sounds like there's an open line of communication, and that's good. And
we'd like to urge not only the residents of the community to get involved in this, but people who are on staff at the hospital. Certainly they are exposed. They're at that hospital every single day. They're exposed to the air right around there. And many of the staff actually live on Beacon Hill as well. We'd also like to urge the local businesses. Community just doesn't mean only the residents. It means everyone, and it includes the businesses on Beacon Hill. So we'd like to urge them to also get involved in this issue with us, as well as any veterans groups that may be concerned.
Sure. So call CCEJ, and also, what else was I going to say? And come to the meeting July 11th. And I think I gave that to Mike as well to put up on the screen.
Okay.
And that's at, I don't think you did that, though. It's at the North Beacon Hill Community Center. And if you call CCEJ, then you can get more information.
Right.
But it's a Saturday.
It's Saturday, it's 10 to noon at the Jefferson Community Center. And that address is 3801 Beacon Avenue.
Mm-hmm. It's right. It's actually right down the street from the hospital. So
yes,
you can go check out the thorn in everyone's side before you come to the meeting. But I think CCEJ and Seattle Healthcare Without Harm, I think they're on a good road to getting response from the VA. And so call those numbers. We're winding up here. And be on the lookout also for more CCEJ actions in the community. I noticed you have a newsletter and...
We have a newsletter that goes out quarterly, and we have a lot of work that we're doing also in the South Park area, which is also affected by the Beacon Hill incinerator. South Park has many, many different health issues. The incinerator is just one of them.
Mm-hmm.
So
the river.
If anybody also would want to get involved in work for the South Park area or any other environmental justice issues,
mm-hmm.
please call.
Well, I thank you both for coming on. I don't know if you have any closing thoughts, but
get active.
Get out there, write to the VA, and shut down the Beacon Hill incinerator. That VA hospital incinerator.
Right.
Alternative waste. And recycle at home as well. Practice what you preach,
right.
All right?
Okay, thanks, Jenny.
Thank you, Jen.
America is essentially a dream.